You've heard already many times from Brenda about this AGCC classification. And with the 7th edition of AGCC, there was also a new classification for uveal melanoma. And at that time, the uveal melanoma classification was based upon a collection by the European Ocular Oncology Group of data from about 7,000 patients. And by analyzing this outcome of the 7,000 patients, we have now an excellent screening system for uveal melanoma. But at that time, there was not yet data for retinoblastoma, and that was the great job of Paul Finger from New York and Brenda from Toronto to collect such information in preparation of the 8th edition. I was involved later in the course when the data had been collected to help in the analysis. The collection, how many years did it take, Brenda, to collect the data through the form?
Oh, it only took 1 year to collect it once it started. But it took a year and a half to get ready to do it, yes.
So in Toronto they have a secure cell. You have to register the study with your ethical committee back in the home, and then you'll get the password to the system, and you can enter the data, which is anonymous to Toronto, but you can use a code that you can later decipher if there is something in the data that you need to check, as there is always in a database like this. And basically, they asked about the patient, the clinical staging, the pathological staging, if there was a nucleation, what treatments were given, and then the outcomes. We started to analyze this a few months ago, so now I'm mostly going to show you the baseline data, what types of tumors there were, how many had metastases at the time of diagnosis, and so on. So this is who entered the data, and I've organized it by the region. We have 6 centers from the Asia Pacific, and the Beijing Tongren alone entered 600 cases, although they don't have complete information for all of those patients. There was someone from Beijing Tongren here.
John.
It's John.
Yeah.
John.
So congratulations for being the number one who has the most cases. And we have from Sankara, who has 121 cases, another Indian center from Narayana.
Ashwin
Nalapatna. Yes, that's right. And then 47 cases from Hong Kong. And the Sydney people, the Australian people just left, but there was from Sydney. And then 33 cases from Singapore. So I think this is rather good representation of the Asia-Pacific region. And the next comes North America, the Children's Hospital Los Angeles with more than 200 cases, and the sick kids with almost the same number. And then St. Jude's and the New York Eye Infirmary. Also a nice representation of North America. And then most cases from Europe actually came from Russia. There is 2 Russian centers with 87 and 60 cases, so 2/3 are Russian patients. Then it's my hospital from Helsinki with 63 cases, and from Barcelona and Spain 11. So this is not as representative.
Now, I ask you just one question, because the center, the 2 centers are from Moscow, Blokhin and Fyodorov.
Yes.
And they have common patient because they move from one set to the other.
We have to check for that. We have to check for that. We have, enough identification information regarding tumor size and so on. That's a good point.
And
we have to check for that.
Is accurate. Yes.
Yes, we have to check for that. And then only 2 centers from South America, from Argentina and Mexico, and the Africa that has most cases is severely underrepresented. But this is not an epidemiological study. It's a proof of concept that you can collect the data in an international collaborative project, and it should be data that you can test your staging. It's enough cases to be representative of any staging system. And now I'd like you to interpret the data for me. I will show you some extracts and point out some differences in treatment, and you can provide the explanation, because oftentimes I don't have the explanation. And I've divided this in treatment. I split the Asia Pacific to China and the other Asia Pacific, which is almost completely India. And then North America, Europe, South America, the Middle East, Africa. And this is the distribution by sex. And you will notice that in Europe it's 50-50. In South America and in the Middle East it's almost 50-50. But in Asia it's 41% female, 44% female. So when do the females disappear in the East?
So my friend mentioned in my presentation yesterday, before yesterday, we have more ovarian patients coming to tertiary rectal centers than families. Even in my study, which was published from a single center in Martin, 600 patients of retinoblastoma, this year in the BJO, we have 60% males and 40%
females. Yeah. So the girls are not brought to treatment.
We have discussed that in the
paper. Probably not probably. Because it's known that there is an interruption of female rearings, correct?
Yeah, but if you look at the population statistics, there is more female. There are four females than in the
reaching this up to the level of tertiary rectal center.
So there is a little bit of
a more likely to bring boys for treatment rather than girls.
So we have a little bit of a blind spot.
Yes.
So that is
some of the girls.
Yes, we have 60% versus 40% female versus 40%.
It's not the genetics.
No, it's not.
Yes.
It's
late.
Okay. Then we have the laterality. And then we also see regional differences. Most notably in Europe, where the only region where there are more bilaterals than unilaterals, possibly because there are more hereditary cases, which are almost mostly bilateral, and which can have several children with retinoblastoma, as we've seen today. But otherwise, it's fairly similar in Asia Pacific, except in China, in North America, in Middle East, Africa, it's about 60%, 40%, which is the classical textbook description of the frequencies of unilateral and bilaterals. And as we've already heard in this course, we have more unilaterals in China, and also even more so in South America. But there must, perhaps, is also some referral bias in these numbers, because they are not national, they are based on referral centers in most of the countries. And this is the division by the Asia diagnosis for Asia Pacific, not for the whole world. There are unilaterals and bilaterals, and by coincidence, 1 year is the maximum diagnosis age, both for unilaterals and bilaterals. But of course, most of the unilaterals are diagnosed after 1 year, and most of the bilaterals are diagnosed before the age of 1 year. But I'd expect that in North America and Europe, you would have the maximum diagnosis of bilaterals around 6 months or so.
I think 12 is still.
Yeah.
I don't think it's
slow
as 6 overall.
Mm-hmm.
Except for the hereditary.
Yeah. Well, we have so many hereditary problems in Finland, the whole is already around 6 to 7 months.
But in the study, you know what you're familiar with.
Mm-hmm. And almost none are diagnosed after the age of 11, even in this region of the world. There were two unilateral cases. This shows you the group of the better eye, and some of them means it was a unilateral case. And here you can read the classification in the website, and this is for the whole world. So you see that if it was a unilateral, the involved eye was in only 1% of the cases, group A, and about half were divided between group D and E in the unilateral cases. It was altogether only 2.5% that were from A to C. And almost the same if the better eye is group A, 90% will be in D and E. And 95% if the better eye is group B, and 100% it is either C or D. And only 5 eyes have group E at the time of diagnosis. And the next is the same. That was in, yeah, that was the first in China, and this was the whole world. So in the whole world we have a little bit more there. It's still about 90% of the unilateral time group D and E. But now we have more group A in the better eye, which is now about 55% in group D and E, about 75% if the better eye is group B, and about 90% if the better eye is group C. So there is difference between China and the rest of the world also in this distribution.
In China, we use the Schnapp standard. So in your country, you may use the Murphy standard. So there's difference between the Schnapp classification and the Murphy classification. So maybe it's not comparable.
No.
No.
All the patients were John's patients in the China study, and they were all classified by the Murphy.
In our hospital,
yeah.
We use
shares. This system of Brenda's collects the elementary data. And out of that elementary data, we have done both the Murphy classification, the Shields classification. So this is entirely comparable in that sense.
Yes.
They are
so
all stages
raw,
the same
raw features of the eye.
Okay.
And then the database classified by 5 different classifications from the raw data.
Yeah. So simplicity,
it doesn't matter what you thought it was, it decides what it thinks it is.
For simplicity, I only saw the international intraocular retinoblastoma, the Murphy classification.
But it's all there.
It is all there,
yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
So in our series also, we had for group A to C, only 5% were unilateral, 95% were bilateral. That means we are not picking up A to C in unilateral cases.
Mm-hmm.
Similar to what we are seeing.
And so now we go to the systemic disease. This is the percentage in different regions who had only intraocular disease and those that have spread to the lymphatics. And the percentage is very small. And what was a small surprise to me, it's only higher in the South America and Middle East Africa region. It's the same in North America, Europe, and the Asia Pacific. In spite of the more locally advanced tumors in Asia Pacific.
So I presume there was a follow-up for diagnosis.
There is a follow-up, yes.
So a minimum follow-up of like 1 year to be able to...
This is the data at the time of diagnosis.
At the time of diagnosis,
yes.
Okay.
The follow-up data is under analysis and not yet presentable.
And the last follow-up date cutoff that I used was 2011, but there's some later than that, so you may choose.
That's right, yes. There's a several-year minimum follow-up for the patient.
Yes.
So
But we chose to not look after, presentation beyond 11, to
yeah, 11, right.
Because treatments have changed so much. You could actually see the difference in countries that only entered more recent patients versus older ones. So we thought that would confuse things.
These localized ones are just being dropped. Only dropping.
That's right. Yes, definitely.
I'm not talking about
orbital
disease.
Yes, we will show
that
in the next slide.
So, how does lymph node invasion
occur
without
orbital
disease?
But it's still possible if you have infiltration in the chamber arm, so that you have tumors entering the Schlemm's canal and the venous circulation. You know, from uveal melanoma that you almost never have especially the lymph nodes, except when you have infiltration to the chamber angle to the conjunctiva where they can go to the blood vessels.
So that
intraocular
disease with lymph nodes spread without any evidence of
obligation? We don't have detailed information of this complication. But this is what you were asking for. The Santana International staging. But before that, these are the detailed findings that made the eye E. And we have here the right eye and the left eye, and then an average percentage that is the average for the right and the left eye. And this is only the eyes in group E. And about 18% of the group E eyes have neovascular glaucoma. People touching the left for what that is for is 7%. Anterior segment tumor is 6%, intraocular hemorrhage is 6%, angloglossal glaucoma and orbital cellulitis in about 2% of the cases, as is also hyphema and phthisis. So these are the elements that make the eye to go into group E. And of course there were some tumors that had a combination of these factors. It was seldom a single factor that made it a group E. And then we had the Chantara classification. This is for the entire material, and you see that it's about half of the cases, because this information was not entered into the database from approximately 50% of the patients. So this data is incomplete. But we had 30% treated conservatively, 73% had at least one eye enucleated, 5% had an eye enucleated and with residual tumor microscopically, and then orbital disease in a combined 1.5%. And in two cases with the pre-auricular. And these numbers are different because we don't have this data for more than half of the patient compared with the lymph node data that were more complete. And then hematogenous metastasis in 8 cases and CNS disease in 11 cases. And I also extracted this data for the Asia Pacific region. And now we actually have a little bit more patients treated conservatively. We have a little less eyes enucleated, but the frequency of the systemic spread is pretty much comparable and actually very rare at this stage. So I'd expect that when the treatment fails and there is several lines tried, there may be later metastasis, and of course not all metastases that are already there will not be evident before they have had some time to grow. If no high-risk characteristics were noted and no systemic adjuvant treatment was given up to the treatment of the eye. And finally, there is some anecdotal data in the notes. This was information that was not collected systematically, but there was a note where the investigators could enter whatever data they felt they would like to communicate to the database. So there were two pairs of identical twins that both had retinoblastoma. They were actually both from Finland. There may be more, but people didn't communicate this information. Only one retinoma was mentioned, which is a great underrepresentation of London. My patients had a mention of a chromosomal deletion visible in chromosomal analysis. Trilateral retinoblastoma of some kind was mentioned in spell cases, that is also a low incidence. Second cancers were mentioned in 10 patients, even though the follow-up for most of these patients was still fairly short. So it was about 15 years for those who were treated in the earliest echelon that was entered into the database. And one suicide was mentioned as a cause of death as well, even though everyone was still younger than about 18 years at the time of the closure of the follow-up. That was the first glimpse into this international data of about 2,000 patients, a little more.
This is the first time I've seen this too. Very, very nice. Thank you very much.